This Let's Edit with Media Composer First tutorial is brought to you by Video Guys, the leading reseller of video editing and production and post-production equipment for over 25 years. And by Boris Effects, a leading developer of visual effects, titling, motion tracking, rotoscoping, and workflow tools and plugins for broadcast, post-production, and film professionals. And by Rampant Design Tools, creators of QuickTime-based style effects for video and designed to significantly enhance content for editors, visual effects artists, and motion graphic designers. Hey everyone, Kevin P. McAuliffe here, and I am back again with another Let's Edit with MC First tutorial. And in this lesson, we're going to keep the ball rolling and we're going to talk about doing some basic editing inside of MC First. Now, this basic editing is what you're going to use to get you up and running to get cuts into a timeline so that you can start to get ready to have something to show to a potential client. Now, in this lesson, we're going to cover basic overwrite and insert editing, and in an upcoming lesson, we're going to cover things like trimming, refining your edit, and audio mixing. All right, now before we go on, I want to remind you that these tutorials are designed to get you up and running in Media Composer First. But what do you do when you're ready to take the plunge into the full version of Media Composer? You're going to want to make the transition from one application to another as smoothly as possible. If this is the situation you're in right now, why don't you head on over and check out my Mac Pro training series on the full version of Media Composer, where lesson one will get you up and running in about an hour. All right, so let's Command or Alt and Tab into MC First. And as you can see, we have our two bins, one called, appropriately enough, Sequences, which is where we will keep our sequences, and the other one called, again, appropriately enough, Clips, which you'll remember from our last lesson. Now, something interesting that I do want to point out, and you're going to notice that we have a little bit of color coding going on here. Now, to be honest, I probably wouldn't have color coded things like this right off the bat, because I find that it can be a little bit confusing, and you're going to see why in just a second. I think it's a good idea that this was done from a standpoint of, okay, it created two clips when it created our project. It created a clips bin and it created a sequence bin. So you'll see the sequence bin is represented by the blue color here, which represents that the sequences will appear over here in the right window. Now, clips will always appear over here in the left window. Now, it seems like a good idea that they would do that, but to be honest, I think this gets a little bit confusing when it comes to toggling the source record monitor. Now, don't worry if you don't know what that means, because I'll show you that at the end of the lesson. Now, you're also going to see down here at the bottom in the timeline, we have a little sort of helper to get us going here that says, drag clips here to start editing. Now, to be honest, I don't recommend that. Media Composer has never really been a great drag and drop editor. It's not like Premiere or Final Cut 7. I'm not even going to go into the Final Cut 10 realm, but Final Cut 7 we'll say for that matter. When it comes to drag and drop editing, Media Composer's strength has always been in the calling up clips into the preview window, choosing the in and out points, and then using the keyboard to drop that into the timeline. Now, speaking of the keyboard, one thing that I want to point out, and this is something that's exceptionally important, you're going to hear me, as we go along, call out a lot of shortcuts, or I'm going to show you where the shortcuts are on the interface. Now, to be honest, what I recommend is to try as little as possible to use the shortcuts on the interface, whether it's in the composer window or whether it's in the timeline down here at the bottom. The reason being is that you'll become a much more faster and proficient editor simply using keyboard shortcuts. If you find yourself constantly going to the drop-down menu to find a command that you use all the time, I highly recommend mapping it to one of those function keys on the keyboard. That's why, for example, I have the audio mixer for my personal settings mapped to F3, because it's something I use all the time. Okay, so let's get a clip in here. And I have these clips here. These are clips that come to us courtesy of ArtBeats. And again, don't forget that if you like these clips and any of the other clips that you see popping up in these tutorials, you can check them out at artbeats.com. Now, something else that I do want to point out, there'll be cases where you'll bring footage into the preview window and you might take a look and be like, wow, the quality doesn't actually look that great. You know, it seems to be a little bit dulled down. I wonder what's going on with that. What's important to keep in mind is that by default, Media Composer is actually running in preview mode. It's not running at the highest resolution in the composer window, and that's a setting that's turned on by default. Now, if you'd like to get in and put this footage at its highest quality, you can actually do that right down here at the bottom of the timeline. You'll see it right here, the video quality menu, and I could right-click on it if I wanted to switch the quality, but what you can also do is just simply click on it to switch over to full green. Full green represents best quality. Now, you'll see that there is not the greatest of qualities. There is sort of the mid-range quality, and there is best quality. It's a very, very marginal difference. But again, it's important if you actually want to see things at their best resolution, especially if you're going to be getting in and doing effects work. Okay, so let's now get in and let's add some in and out points to drop this into my timeline. To mark an in point, very straightforward, the I key on the keyboard. To mark an out point, the O key on the keyboard. And much like, you know, you would think if I'm dragging through and I want to mark an in point anywhere I see it, I could just simply hit that in point and there we go. There's the in point dropped in. You'll see I can drop it in there. I can drop it in there. I can, of course, also play this clip, and anytime I see an in point, I can simply hit the in point just like such. Now, one thing I do want to point out is that if you are dragging, much like I showed you before, and you hit in point right there and you keep dragging and you let go, the in point's going to be added wherever the time bar ends up stopping, not where you necessarily added it. So for example, if I add that in point here, but I don't let go till here, the in point's going to appear where you stop and let go of the mouse. Okay? So I'm just going to mark an in point sort of in about this range here. Now, I could take this clip, because it is the first one, and drag it and drop it down here into a new timeline, but I'm going to use the keyboard shortcut to begin editing. I'm going to use the B key on the keyboard. That is on both Mac and Windows, and that is to perform an overwrite edit. So as soon as I drop that in there, there's the overwrite edit that puts the first clip in our timeline. Now, you'll also see that these audio tracks were put in there. So what's going on with that? Well, if you remember one of our previous lessons on settings, and I come down to the timeline setting, by default, inside of the Edit tab, you'll see that a new sequence will always add one video track and two mono audio tracks to get us rolling. Okay? Now, for right now, we're not going to worry about the audio. I'm not going to delete it, but we're not going to worry about it for right now. I'm going to talk about audio in an upcoming lesson. Okay? So let's put a second clip in. Okay, let's just grab another waterfall shot. Sure, why not this majestic looking one here? Let's make sure I don't hit the trim mode. Don't worry, again, we're going to talk about trim mode in an upcoming lesson too. And because I'm taking this clip and I'm going to be dropping it right after this clip, and I happen to be down at the end of the timeline, I'm going to use B again on the keyboard to drop that in. Now, the B key on the keyboard, the B command, is an overwrite edit. Okay, so let's now talk about the difference between an overwrite edit and an insert edit. The insert edit shortcut on the keyboard is the V key, which of course happens to fall immediately to the left of the B key. So let me call up my other waterfall shot here. There we go. Now, is this the one that's sitting stationary? It is. Perfect. Okay, I'm going to mark an in point. Now, what I'd actually like to do is to use 3 seconds of this. So how I see a lot of editors get rolling is they say, okay, I'm going to scroll down, and what I'm going to do, because I actually have the center duration up here in between the two time codes, I'm just going to go down to about 3 seconds, which is right about, there we go, and I'm going to do it there. Wow, that's the long way of doing things. Where instead what you could do is just go plus 3 seconds. Now, you'll notice that as soon as I put the 00 in, it appeared immediately as 00. Because what I like to do is instead of pressing 0 and 0 on the keyboard, I actually use the period key on the numeric pad, which on Media Composer is for a 00. Now, as soon as I hit enter, this is going to give me 3 seconds, but what's important to keep in mind is that first frame is actually included in that duration. So if I actually wanted to add 3 seconds in here, because I'm in a 2398 project, I'm actually going to go plus 223 and hit enter, and then I'm going to mark that as an out point, and that will give me a perfect 3 seconds. So keep that in mind. When you're adding time, you always want to go one frame less than the actual time that you want, so this way you always get it every time, okay? So let's now come back, and I don't think I'm actually going to go right at the edit point, but if I wanted to, I could always hold Command or Control on Windows to snap to that edit point, which is very handy, okay? But I'm going to come to the midpoint of our first shot, maybe a little bit farther down here, okay? And we want to now take this clip, and I'd like to drop it into my timeline, and I'd like to lay it right over top of the clip that's there. Basically, like taking it, smashing it down, so that we're just going to add it in between these two shots. Now to do that, we're gonna use the same command that we've been using up until this point, which is overlay. So I'm gonna press B on the keyboard to drop that clip in, and you'll now see that we have one waterfall that's gonna cut into another waterfall that is going to cut into the last waterfall. Now, one thing with this process, it's what I like to call non-destructive, meaning if I take this clip and I drop it into V1 as an overwrite, I don't have anything else selected on any other tracks, nothing is going to be impacted as far as the timing of my sequence goes. But let's undo that for 1 second. Let's now use an insert command to drop the next clip down. Okay, now an insert is a destructive process, meaning that if you're not careful, you can easily push your clips out of sync by only inserting onto one track and not doing it to all the tracks to push everything down accordingly. So you'll notice that as soon as I hit V on the keyboard on both Mac and Windows, the clip has now been taken at the point that I was at, and everything behind it has been pushed down the timeline. Okay, there we go. We're gonna come back to the same shot and then cut to the next shot. Okay, so that is the basic idea of an insert and an overwrite edit. Okay, now, something else I do want to point out, we were talking about timings when we were coming in and choosing the duration of this clip. Well, hypothetically, if I wanted to get in and I wanted to come back 5 seconds in my timeline, again, I always see people going, okay, I'm at the 622 mark, let's now come back to, I think that's like 122, you don't need to do any of that. -5 seconds, boom, there you go. Exactly where you should be. Now you can mark it in, hit V on the keyboard, and you're all set to go. All right, so what I want to do for this lesson is I want to wrap things up by talking about that toggle source record monitor and what exactly does that mean. Okay, so I'm going to take a clip that I haven't used yet. Let's use this one. Okay, and I'm just going to clear the monitor. I'm just going to give it a duration of, I don't know, let's go 423, mark that as an endpoint. Let's actually go +423. There we go, because I wanted it to be 5 seconds long. There we go. I'm gonna hit B to drop that into my timeline. Now, what I'd like to do is I'd like to drop some clips from this. Now, what I should actually do here, and I break my own rules here. We're gonna call this waterfall timeline, okay? And we're gonna call this mountain timeline, okay? Just so we can keep track of everything. Now, you'll notice that as soon as I enter the names of these two sequences, it immediately updates in the upper right-hand corner. And you can, of course, switch back between sequences, much like clips, by simply double-clicking on them. Now, if you don't want to go about switching them that way, you can always come up to the actual timeline sequence and switch them up here as well, okay? So, let's now talk about what would happen with our mountain sequence if I wanted to add a couple clips from the waterfall timeline. Well, this is normally what I see people do. They'll double click and they'll be like, oh, I called it up here. That's not what I wanted to do. So let me double click on the mountain timeline. So I'm going to drag it up into this window and I'm going to try to figure out where that edit point is so I can only put this shot in. Well, this is where the beauty of the toggle source record monitor comes into play. And this is a feature that's very unique to Media Composer. I see editors in other NLEs saying, oh, I wish we had this. I'd actually like to see what is going on in this window, as opposed to always seeing this window represented down here in the timeline. So with the toggle source record monitor option, I can actually now view the contents of the preview monitor here in the timeline window. And you'll see the color of the time bar has now changed to green. I can now get in and pick exactly the portion of the shot that I want to come down and edit into this timeline. So the toggle source record monitor, a fantastic feature that I guarantee you're gonna be using all the time, maybe something that you're gonna wanna have mapped to a keyboard shortcut. Now, as I wrap up this lesson, I wanna take a moment to thank our sponsors, starting out with Video Guys. They are my preferred reseller for both video hardware and software, and when you're ready to make the next step to the full version of Media Composer, Video Guys will be there to help you make your upgrade as smooth as possible. You can check them out at videoguys.com and you can use the coupon code MC101 for 5% off your Video Guys purchase. I also want to thank Boris Effects and the Boris Effects family of visual effects software, including GenArt Sapphire and Imagineer Systems Mocha. Don't forget, you can work with all their effects inside of Media Composer first by making your purchase through the Avid Marketplace, and you can check them out at boriseffects.com. And finally, I want to thank Rampant Design Tools, the leaders in QuickTime-based style elements that work perfectly inside of Media Composer First. You can check out their entire product line at rampantdesigntools.com and even download over 40 free 4K effects at 4kfree.com. And finally, if you have any questions, you have any comments, or you have any tutorial requests, you can send them to Kevin P. McAuliffe at gmail.com. This has been Kevin P. McAuliffe. Thanks a lot for watching.